it's like a default position. That, you know, we all have jobs, we have families, we have responsibilities to our parents, to our children, to the society, and that all comes within the realm of the karma. So we had completed until the 18th verse of the third chapter, and because we are catching up after a while, I'll do a quick recap, or maybe you can do a quick recap. Just go around and see what is it that you remember, or what is it that stuck to your mind about the third chapter. It's not really fair because I think it's almost a month since our last class. But what is it that stuck to your mind the most? Some of the verses that we read.
Arjuna's confusion whether Karma Yoga is better or Bhakti Yoga.
Very good. So that's how the chapter starts. That's the segue into the chapter. Then in the second chapter, Krishna presents two apparently contradictory positions. In 49, he says that give up all karma. And then in 51, he says do your duty. 251. So Arjuna has heard both the verses. And so he opens up the third chapter by saying, you know, can you tell me which is better? For me, karma is better, which is doing my prescribed duties, or is jnana better, which is, in Arjuna's mind, a karma. So jnana means that you basically sit and read, but you don't do any activities. So that's how the third chapter begins, with Arjuna frankly putting his confusion in front of his spiritual master and the personality of Godhead, Krishna. How does Krishna respond? So Krishna says that that there are two categories of people. There are one kind of people take to karma, one kind of people take to jnana. And in that he gives us a perspective as to why there are multiple paths in the Vedas. It's not because Krishna is confused about how you can come to him, but it's because we have different propensities. Some of us will never take to jnana. Some of us will never take to, I hope it doesn't happen, but some of us can never take to bhakti. And some of us are naturally attracted to astanga yoga, the yogic process. So Krishna casts a wide net. He wants different people. In fact, he casts such a wide net that there are parts of the Vedas that even deal with tamasic people. You know, there's part of the Vedas that deal with what is called black magic. Things to do with different kind of getting different kind of siddhis for material purposes, getting control of various abilities. They're all in the Vedas. And so Vedas are from there all the way to Shuddha. Krishna talks about the most exalted platform of devotion, and it's basically because we are all there. There are some of us in the mode of ignorance, passion, goodness, pure goodness, and the Vedas have a hope where we can each anchor ourselves into. So he says that because of this reason, there is a part of karma and jnana, but at this stage he is saying to Arjuna, karma is better for you. And he gives three reasons why karma is better. First reason he says is the most important, that the senses by nature are very active and they require engagement. So if you do not engage in karma, then your senses will be agitated but will not have any way to satisfy their needs. The tongue needs to eat, and the ear needs to hear. So all the senses require some kinds of engagement, and specifically for an embodied soul. So by nature, the soul has senses that are active. For an embodied soul, the senses are hyperactive.
because they have been materially constrained. So they're really seeking some kind of engagement. And the reason they're hyperactive is because material engagements never actually satisfy. So it's like a thirsty person drinking from one glass to another glass to another glass, but the thirst is not getting quenched. So he continues to try to drink from various glasses. And that's how our senses are constantly looking at different objects and engaging with them, that will you give me satisfaction, will you give me satisfaction? And the answer is to begin with yes, and then it becomes no, and then the senses move to another object there. So Krishna says, you're an embodied soul, the senses by nature are active. So if you do not engage in any activity, your senses will force you to engage in activities. The second reason that he gives is that in order to sustain yourself, you have to do some activities. Then he says that na prasadiyeta karmana, that without by a karmana, if you don't do any activities, you will not be able to sustain yourself. So in this material world, there is the body that we get, which we need to constantly nourish. Then the soul is eternal, but not the body. The nature of the body is that at every moment it is trying to, because it is material, it is asat, at every moment it is trying to dissolve itself. So we have to do everything that we can to maintain. Even then it's a losing battle, but we try to do everything. We try to give it food and water and air and everything that it needs, so that it can can stay around for some time. So Krishna tells Arjuna that if you don't do this karma, then how are you going to sustain yourself? And then the third reason that he says is that because Arjuna is a perfected soul, but in this mood he is one who's looking for purification. He says that this karma will actually offer you purification. That when you engage in this karma, then this will be your means for purification. So Arjuna then catches on to the last one. He says, how does karma purify? What is the nature of karma that offers us purification? Because he says, what I have heard is that so these are implicit dialogues. He doesn't really recite those verses, but the acharyas say that there is a lot of undercurrent that is going on. He says, what I have heard about karma is that it is binding. How can it be purifying? So Krishna then gives the example that karma is non-different from yajna. He says, yajna shishta sanasanta yajna-thart karma no nyatra loko yam karma bandana tadartham karma kaunteya mukta sam samachara. That he says that by performing this yajna, which is actually a prescribed duty, mukta sam samachara, that what you're thinking is binding you will actually liberate you. And then he says, let me explain how. He says that when this universe was created, then three things came. What are the three things? The jivas came, the scriptures came, and the demigods came. And Lord Vishnu, he gave the rules of engagement for all three of them. The duty of the demigods is to take care of the jivas. The duty of the jivas is to please the demigods. How these two things happen are given in the scriptures. So the jivas, by following the scriptures, serve the demigods, and the demigods, pleased by the service of the jivas, give them all the necessities for them to live. And he says, in this way, by mutual cooperation, everybody flourishes. So the prescribed duties, so this is one question, that is often asked, that what is my duty? Especially for people who at least are attracted more to the karma part of the Bhagavad Gita, they ask this question, that I understand that Krishna is recommending karma, but what is my duty? And Krishna is explaining here that your duty is given to you in the scriptures. And that is also the reason why it's so difficult to follow karma in Kali Yuga. Because firstly, the scriptures are not available. And secondly, even the ability to implement the duties that are given in the scriptures is very much constrained. The ability to give in charity, the ability to serve your parents, the ability to serve the society. So there are so many injunctions that are given in the scriptures, and very, very specific injunctions. The Karma Kanda of the Vedas, which is the predominant part of the Vedas, more than 90% of the Vedas is Karma Kanda. So the Karma Kanda of the Vedas is very, very prescriptive about how the conduct of different people in different scenarios. What do you do as a son for your parents? What do you do as a father to your child, as a husband to your wife, in different scenarios of health and sickness and happiness and distress? So it's almost like a rule book. That so that's why in the earlier times, the families, they would have a priest known as a Purohit. So Purohit was basically one who was expert in the Karma Kanda. So Purohit means Purna Hit. Hit means one who is doing it for your benefit, and Purna means complete. So the Purohit was a person who would advise the family on different aspects of Karma Kanda. What kind of yagyas to do, what kind of charity to give. If there was a dispute, then the person would, on the basis of the scriptures, help to resolve the dispute. So we don't have access to those Vedas. And we don't have access to the people who are qualified to explain that. But at least in this, for the sake of completeness, Krishna is saying that if you follow your karma perfectly, then not only does it satisfy the senses of your embodied soul, not only will it help you sustain yourself, it will also purify your very existence. And then he explains this theory with an example, and he gives the example of food grains. So he gives the example of how from the Vedas comes the yajna, by the performance of the yajna comes rain, from the rain comes grain, from the grain the jiva sustains himself. Once the jiva is healthy, they read the scriptures and they perform the yajna. So this is the cycle of existence. And he says, one yajna shishta sanasanta muchyante sarvakilbisha bhunjate yutagam papa ye pachante atma karanat. He says that one who does not follow the cycle of existence in the perspective of grain eats only sin. Because you're stealing. So it's like the Vedas say that in order to get grains from the Devas, you have to perform yajna. By not performing yajna, when you're eating grains, you're basically stealing it. If you're stealing it, you're committing a crime, which means that you will have to pay for it later on. So, proceeding from that, Krishna gives Arjun two verses in which he talks about nishkam karma. So, he doesn't want us and Arjun to think that karma is all in all, because it's not. So he says, but there is another category of people who don't have to perform karma. Those are the people who are fully self-satisfied, which is Krishna's way of saying that they're fully detached. They have no aspirations for any material comfort. Whatever comes by their way, they're happy with it. If nothing comes, they're still satisfied. So he talks about this category of people. And Arjun might then immediately think, because Arjun's mind at this point is that he doesn't want to fight the war. So he might think that, why don't I become that person? Why don't I become a person who's totally atmarati? One who is, atmarati is a person who is self-satisfied. Why don't I become an atmarati? And Krishna then, he anticipates that, and then he says, even such a person who is fully self-satisfied, who has no need to perform any karma, even he should perform karma. So that gets us to the 19th verse, right? So quick recap of the first 18 verses. So the verse 19 is, therefore, without being attached to the fruits of activities, one should act as a matter of duty, for by working without attachment, one attains supreme. So if one is fully detached, there is no need for the person to perform any activities. But Krishna is saying that for even for such a person, he should act as a matter of duty, because that will lead him to the supreme. And how this leads to the supreme, Krishna will elaborate in subsequent verses. So he gives the example of two people in this to illustrate that why even one who is fully detached did act as a matter of duty, and why did they act as a matter of duty. So the one person whose example that he gives is Maharaj Janak, and the second person whose example that he gives is himself. So we'll read those verses. Kings such as Janak attain perfection solely by performance of prescribed duties. Therefore, just for the sake of educating the people in general, you should perform your work. So Krishna is giving the reason that why should such, how do such people get purification? Even though they don't need to act, they are acting. And the reason that they are acting is because they want to set an example for other people. And how, why do they attain perfection? Because of that? Because they get the mercy of Krishna. So a person who helps another person make spiritual advancements immediately gets the mercy of Krishna. So even, and that's why Prabhupada would say that even if you yourself are struggling, you should still help others. Because in the material conception, they say, if you're struggling, how can you help others? Both of you will drown. Like if a person is in the water and he's struggling, you don't know how to swim, you jump in the water, both the people will drown. In the spiritual conception, it's exactly the opposite. You know, Prabhupada said that to the level that your realization permits, you should preach. Because when Krishna sees you preaching, then his mercy flows abundantly to you. And then he empowers you for further realizations, for further understanding, for further steadiness in your spiritual practices. And as you make use of everything that Krishna is giving you to help others, Krishna will give you more and more and more. And that's how he says, such a person attains perfection. So he's very affectionate towards Maharaj Janak. Maharaj Janak is one of the 12 Mahajans. He is a person who has perfectly understood the whole intricacies of karma. So it is said that karma is very simple in a principle, but very difficult in its implementation. Because the principle of karma is very straightforward, that whatever you do, as you do, you shall suffer the consequences. What you sow, you reap. For every action, there is a reaction. Can't be any simpler than that. But what is the reaction to the action? That is where the whole complexity of karma comes. That you give some money to a beggar, he takes that money and buys a knife and kills somebody, you're implicated in that karma, even though you may not be aware of it. Like Maharaj Nigi, right? He gave cows in charity. One of the cows that he gave to one of the Brahmin, it left the herd and joined the other Brahmin's herd. Because of that, and this was, you know, Maharaj Vinraj Nirgi found out about it, he went to the first Brahmin and he said, for the first cow that you have lost, I will give you 100,000 cows. And the Brahmin refused. And he said that, you have given me charity, you have taken it back, and I don't want anything to do with you. And because of that offense, Maharaj Nirgi, who was a very exalted king, he had to take a body of a lizard for a very, very long time. from Satyuga all the way to Dwapara Yuga. Millions of years, the poor guy was in a lizard's body. His body was effulgent, but I don't know how much that helped him. Because when Krishna was in Dwarka, then his children were playing and they came to him and they said that in this well there is a lizard that is shining. And then Krishna looked at it and he saw it was Maharaj Nrigi. So he extended his hand and he took the lizard out. And of course then Maharaj Nrigi immediately got liberated by the touch of Krishna. So he did get some benefit of all the pious activities that he had done. But he also had to suffer a lot. So Maharaj Janak is a person who perfectly understood this, but yet he performed his activities as prescribed to set an example for others. Next verse, 21. Whatever actions a great man performs, other men follow. And whatever standards he sets by exemplary skills, all the world pursues. So this is one of Srila Prabhupada's favorite verses. Yad yad achrati shesha tatta devata rojana sa yad pranam kurute lokastha anuvartate. So we see in our own life, right, we try to emulate great people. We try to read their thoughts, their books, the quotes by great people. If in our immediate circle there is somebody who is an exalted person, we get attracted to the person, we try to follow either the person's instructions or the person's actions. So this is the reason why Krishna is saying that even if a person who is perfected and doesn't need to perform activities, he should perform activities because other people are watching him. So Maharaj Janak, who is a great king, and who, if he had renounced everything, then other people would prematurely renounce. And we'll see that what Krishna is actually doing is, he is building a case against Arjun. Because Arjun himself, he's a great prince. He has so many people who are idolizing him. And if he gave up his weapons and walked off out of Kurukshetra, half the army would walk off with him. Everybody would say that, I have taken sannyas too, whether they are ready or not to take sannyas. So, now that Krishna has introduced the concept of greatness, he has to speak about himself also. So, next verse he speaks about himself is, O son of Pritha, there is no work prescribed for me within all the three planetary systems. Nor am I in want of anything, nor have I a need to obtain anything. And yet I am engaged in prescribed duties. We see two things in this verse. One is that this quality of being detached, you see Krishna is glorifying it in himself. And that's one reason why he appreciates it in us also. That he says, I'm not in the want of anything, there's nothing in this three world that I need. In Krishna's case, if he wants anything, he can get it. But despite, he's at a different position. That we are at a position that even if we want it, we may not be able to get it. But Krishna's position is that nothing in the three worlds is outside my reach. But yet, I don't care for it. So that is the ultimate vairagya. Right? There's one vairagya is that example that is given that there was a Brahman who was crossing the bridge. And he had a sack of flour on his shoulder, so the bridge was rickety rackety, and it was the wind was blowing, so his sack it slipped from his shoulder and it fell over to the river. So as it was falling over the river, he was shouting, "Krishna arpanate, Krishna arpanate." So he's like, "It's in any way I'm not getting it, so let me offer it to Krishna." So that's one renunciation that I'm not going to get a Mercedes, so I go around saying that, I don't really care about the Mercedes, and I don't really care about those big mansions in Potomac, because I'm not going to get them. So that's one kind of renunciation, but me saying that, I don't want potatoes. Let's say I can get potatoes; they're cheap. So that is renunciation that it's something that is within my realm of acquisition, and I say I don't want it. So within Krishna's grasp, everything is there. And then he's saying that I don't really care about it. And he's like I said, he's setting these two examples. That one, his appreciation for detachment, and the second is, he says, yet I perform my prescribed duties. When Krishna was in Dwarka, then he was perfect everything. He was a perfect husband. Prabhupada would say he was a perfect husband, and Prabhupada says that the Vedic definition of a perfect husband is a henpecked husband. That the husband follows within the house all the instructions of the wife. And he gives the example of Krishna. That when Krishna gets up in the morning, his wife scolds him. All his wives scold him. So he has 16,108 wives scolding him. And then Krishna says, you know, yes, yes, yes. And then after that, his children come and they climb on his shoulders. And they jump on his stomach, and Krishna patiently, he tolerates all that. Then he does his morning worship. He worships Suryadev, he worships the Brahmins, he gives in charity. Then he goes to the court, and then he stands with folded hands in front of Maharaj Ugrasen, because Ugrasen is the king. And Maharaj Ugrasen, he gives duties to everybody, and Krishna says, yes, yes, you know, whatever you ask me to do, I'll do. And then he gets back at home in the evenings. His wife scolds him again in the evening, and then they serve him food, and you know, and Krishna appreciates the food. So in all perspectives, Krishna was perfect, even though Krishna had no need to do anything, but because he wanted to set an example for everybody. The only one time where Krishna strayed away from the path of prescribed duties is in the first 11 years in Vrindavan. There he played his Bhagavat Leela. So he was God at the time. So he was stealing from people's houses, he was running around with other people's wives. Of course, Krishna doesn't want us to do that. But at that point he was playing he was saying that I'm God. As God, I can do anything. I can lift a mountain. I can kill a 7-mile-long demon. I can kill a snake whose body is humongous. I can fly in the sky. I can do anything. So when we see Krishna's Vrindavan Leela, then we say, okay, so this is God. This is a small, small smidgen of what God can do. And that inspires us to surrender to him. When we see Krishna's Dwarka Leela, then we say that this is what God wants us to do, and then we follow his. So in Vrindavan, the Vrindavan Leela is there to inspire devotion in us. And of course, the other reason is that everything that Krishna did in Vrindavan was to satisfy his devotees. That Krishna says, ye thamam prapadyante tamsate bhajam. As one worships me, I reciprocate. So people who wanted Krishna as their child, Krishna came as their child. People who wanted Krishna as a lover, Krishna came as the lover. People who wanted to have extramarital relationship with Krishna, Krishna came in the parakriya bhav. So for his devotees, he'll do anything. He doesn't really care at that time that what will people think about me. I am God, but I'm running around with the wives of other people. I am God, but I'm stealing from other people's houses. I am God, but I'm stealing the garments of women. What will people think about me? So when his devotees are in play, Krishna does not care about anything. All that he wants is to satisfy his devotees. Any questions, comments? Okay, so my next verse is, for if I ever fail to engage in carefully performing prescribed duties, O Parth, certainly all men would follow my path. So Krishna is calling Arjun Parth. So Parth is son of Pritha. So he's reminding Arjun that you're also connected to you have a mother. You're connected to a dynasty. And you have your duties in that dynasty also. So through this, and we see this name play going on throughout Bhagavad Gita, that Arjun calls Krishna by different names to invoke different moods of Krishna. Krishna calls Arjun by different names to remind him of his various responsibilities. So he's calling him Partha, that you're son of Pratha. You're connected to this really illustrate Kuru Vansh. So what will your mother think? What will your dynasty think if you do not perform your prescribed duties? If I did not perform prescribed duties, all this world would be put in ruination. I would be the cause of creating unwanted population, and I would thereby destroy the peace of all living beings. So if you remember in the first chapter when Arjun was giving reasons to not fight the war, he gave 5 reasons. One of the reasons was Varna Sankar. He gave the reason that that when the elders in the family are killed, the women will become polluted. And when the women are polluted, then unwanted progeny will be created. Krishna is saying that that's not true. When you don't perform your prescribed duties, that's when this will happen. Because the purpose of prescribed duties is to have you control your senses. And if people do not perform the prescribed duties, then their senses will run amok. And that is what will cause the ruination of the society. As the ignorant perform their duties with attachment to results, the learned may similarly act, but without attachment, for the sake of leading people on the right path. So, at this point, Krishna is answering Arjuna's implicit question that you have talked about 2 kinds of people, sakam karma and nishkam karma. People who are doing their activities in order to enjoy the fruits of the activities, and people like Maharaj Janak and Krishna himself, who have no attachment to their activities, but are still performing it to set an example for others. So Krishna says that the difference is that the ignorant, they will perform the duties in order to get the results of the activities. The enlightened will also perform the duties, not because they are desiring the results of the duties, but only to set an example for other people. The difference is in the consciousness of the two. So externally they may look the same, but internally the consciousness will be completely different. Verse 26, so as not to disturb the mind of ignorant men attached to the fruitive results of prescribed activities, a learned person should not induce them to stop work. Rather, by working in the spirit of devotion, he should engage them in all sorts of activities for the gradual development of Krishna consciousness. So, Krishna is now talking about the duty of an enlightened person. Because if an enlightened person goes to somebody who is not at that level and says that this cycle of karma is binding, it will actually result in your continued birth and death. The person says, what should I do? He says, don't do karma. It will free you. He says, okay. He goes home, he leaves his wife, he leaves his children, he goes to some jungle and he sits over there and his senses are rampant at the time because he has not been internally purified. Actually, examples of a lot of these things that happen when people, they start following some fake sadhus, or even if they're following genuine sadhus, they're not getting the right message. And they give up their families, not because they're looking for enlightenment, but because they get an escape clause, that they don't want to take on the burden of the families, and they say, I'm now a vairagi. And they leave their families and then they go. And then the senses force them to do even more sinful activities there. So Krishna is saying that so as not to mislead such ignorant men, the enlightened person should actually ask them to do their activity. One of the things that Prabhupada would say to people who would come, and his disciples and other people, they would come and they say, Prabhupada, I want to leave my job, I want to leave my family. And Prabhupada used to be very, very heavy on that, saying that don't leave your job, take care of your family, but do it all as an offering to Krishna. So that's why, so the things within the bracket is not the translation of the verse, but Prabhupada's instruction, that for the gradual development of Krishna consciousness, that as one acts in this mood of service, then Krishna consciousness will develop gradually. So verse 27 is Krishna giving a more a technical difference between sakam karma and nishkam karma. So he's explained earlier on in this early set of verses that even if a person has no desire for any fruits of the activity, he should not give up karma. He should still perform the activities so as to set an example for the others and so as to not mislead the others. So then Arjun might ask that, give me more understanding of the difference between sakam karma and niskam karma. So the verse 27 is a fairly famous verse, prakriti kriyamanani guna karmani sarvasha ahankara vimudatma karta ahamiti manyate. So this describes the position of a sakam karmi. So when a person is materially attached, then the activities themselves are done by the modes of material nature. So a person can be either in the mode of goodness, passion or ignorance. And because the person is under the modes, all the activities that the person will be doing are actually executed by the modes of material nature. So this is an interesting aspect that begins from this verse and develops in the rest of the Bhagavad Gita as to who is the doer. So in this verse, Krishna is saying that prakriti kriyamanani guna karmani sarvasha and ahankara vimudatma karta amiti manyate, that if you think that you are doing these activities, vimudatma, he says you are muda. Muda means as, and vimudha means real big ass. So he says that you're really an illusion if you think you are doing these activities. Actually, they are done by prakriti kriyamanani. That are actually being done by the modes of material nature. And to some extent, we can see that in ourselves. We can see that experientially also. That we see a person very strongly in the mode of goodness, and we know the kind of activities that the person will do. We see a person strongly in the mode of passion, we know the kinds of activities that the person will do, because they are being driven by the modes of material nature. Similarly for the mode of ignorance. But this is a subject that it starts from here, but then over time what Krishna will put in different players. At this point he says that prakriti kriyamanani. Then he says, nādate kaścit pāpam nācayavya sukritam vidu. That he says that I don't do anything. In case Arjun, some people say, jo bhi karta bhagwan karta hai. So Krishna says, nādate kaścit pāpam, that I'm not responsible for your sinful activities, nācayavya sukritam vidu. Nor am I responsible for your sukritam, for your pious activities. I don't know the verse number. So it's basically something that you do yourself. So he's absolving himself also. Then he says in the the soul is not doing anything. So he's saying the modes of material nature are doing everything. I'm not doing anything. The soul is not doing anything. And then later on he says that everybody is doing something. So then he tries to bring everything back together. He says that as the Paramatma, I'm the person who's inspiring you to act. He says, as the Jiva, you're the person who's responsible for every activity that you're doing. Because if you think about it, Prakriti is inert. So I commit sinful activities and I say Prakriti has done it. You punish Prakriti, don't punish me. But at the end of the day, who's getting punished? The Jiva is getting punished. Right? So culpability can only come when there is accountability there. So at the end of the day, then Krishna, so he builds it a little bit like a suspense thriller, that the who done it, who does the activities, Prakriti does it, Krishna does it, Jiva does it, who does it, and then he will try and bring it all together. But this is the point where he starts that discussion. So this verse 27 is obviously speaking about a person who is sakam, because he is completely being driven by the modes of material nature, which basically are forcing him to seek enjoyment. So next verse he speaks about a person who is a nishkam. One who is in knowledge of the absolute truth, O mighty armed, does not engage himself in senses and sense gratification, knowing well the difference between work and devotion and the work for fruitive results. So difference between nishkam and sakam karmi. Nishkam karmi knows well that what is the result of working with attachment. So what is the result? What do we understand? What is the result for working with attachment either to the work or to the fruits? How does it manifest in our lives?
It keeps us bound to that, and then you do it, you expect something, and then you do it again. And
that's very good. So one thing is that it binds us to that karma. So every activity that you do, it lays a seed of itself in your heart or in your subtle body. And that is why if as you do pious activities, you get addicted to doing pious activities. Do sinful activities, you get addicted to doing sinful activities. Because they are self-perpetuating. The nature of karma is like that, that it leaves a bija. The bija then becomes kuta, which means that from unmanifest it becomes slightly apparent. From kuta it becomes a prarabd, means that it is. So the three stages of activities are, four stages are thinking, feeling, willing and doing. So there are so many activities that we think about, that I could do this. Some are good, some are bad. Sometimes we think that, you know, if only I could eradicate poverty in this world, or if only I could, you know, no child should die in this world. So we have all these thoughts that come to our mind. Sinful thoughts also come, that, you know, if only my neighbor would be get run over by a car, or if only my boss fell out of the window. So all these sinful thoughts also come. So, you know, why? All these things come. Why? Because these are the seeds of the karma that are planted in our heart. So, out of those millions of thoughts, a few of them we extract and we start contemplating it. So from thinking, it goes to feeling. So contemplating means that we start, without actually doing the activity, we start either enjoying or suffering that activity. So like Mark Twain says that my whole life is full of one catastrophe after another, and some of them actually happened. So that's the nature. We keep thinking of so many things that, you know, what happens if I fall sick, if I do this and that. So that's the next stage of karma. It goes from thinking to feeling. Then a subset of that, we actually make plans to happen. That is willing. That we say that, okay, we would like this to happen. I would like my health to improve. I would like to travel, take a vacation. I would like to do something to give back to the society, to cook somewhere, to help a person. So we start making plans for that, that maybe I can join Meals on Wheels, maybe I can do some philanthropic activity, maybe I can, you know, help my neighbors. And a small fraction of what we will, we actually do. So it all starts from thinking, which is the bij of karma that has come. So that is one thing, that karma results in the desire to perform more karma. What else does karma result in, Parikshit?
Reinforces identification of the body, mind.
makes it harder to make spiritual progress?
To some extent, yes. So, we would then speak specifically about sakam karma. That when we do karma with the explicit desire to enjoy the activities, then it strongly reinforces our bodily conception. Because when we do karma in that mood, then there are two conceptions that are prevalent. That aham karta, aham bhogi. I am the doer, I am the enjoyer. That because of me this activity has been done, and what has been done by this activity is for me. So it centers around the me. So yeah, you're right. So when person performs sakam karma, then yes, it reinforces very strongly the concept of being the enjoyer. And that translates into the bodily conception, because you need your body to enjoy. So that's second. What else?
It also develops ego.
That's a very good point. So the notion of being so you'll notice that people who are in the mode of passion, they have a very strong sense of being in control of the destiny. That everything that happens to me is because I will it to happen. And you know, many of them are strong people, skillful, talented people who have been able to accomplish a lot. I was in a conference call today with a CEO of a company, a small company, and I've been speaking with the salespeople for a while, and things were not working out. So you know, we were like, you know, going back and forth, and it was interesting. When I spoke to the CEO, the conversation was completely different. You know, the other people were like, you know, this product can do this, it can't do this, and you know, these are the challenges. And the CEO was like, tell me what you need to do, I'll make it happen for you. And I could see why he was in that position, because he had that conception that whatever you need to do, I can make it happen. And he said, if I can't make it happen, of course, this is a CEO of the US company, he said, if I can't make it happen, nobody can make it happen. So then I said, I'll take you on the first part. The second part I can't, because if you don't make it happen, I'll go to another vendor there. But I could see that, you know, he had this natural sense of that, you know, I'm able to do whatever needs to be done. So very strong sense of, like ego you're saying, that, you know, that and if anybody can do it, I can do it. What else?
Akshay? Does it also result in self-realization as we bhog it more and more, and eventually it vanishes? Does it happen? It results in a zero or two.
It does. It's a good point that you know, it ultimately does reveal the futility of karma. And some people it does, some people it doesn't. If a person is introspective, they're able to look back at their lives, at all everything that they've achieved or not, then they do get a sense of of automatically of detachment. One of a devotee's friends, he was sharing. He's Western, and his father was in his dying bed. He knew that he was going to pass away. So the son is a devotee, the father is not. But it was very interesting that the last few minutes his father was saying that so many things I've done in this life, you know, they're all useless. Yeah. And he was saying that I could immediately hear Krishna's verse in my mind that the nature of karma is that it will continue to entrap you until you get those kinds of realization. So yeah, if in a proper environment, it can actually give you detachment.
So on this bit, I just wanted, something came to mind is in economics, one of the basic principles is diminishing marginal utility.
Yes.
Which is the more you have of a thing, the less you want to have more of it.
Yes.
So
yes.
Just,
yes.
Just something that came to mind.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, interestingly, there is, so it's not bona fide, but there is a group of people who basically preach that the way to get to develop detachment is by overindulgence. Right? So they say that do it so much that you get sick.
Osho.
Yeah. I don't know if anybody is a follower of Osho, so I but
I was forced to read it when I was in the writing period.
Oh really?
They say you don't know it, that you must know it. Why you're in it?
Actually,
just on similar kind of the similar lines of what Mataji had spoken to the false ego. Does the heart also get hardened of such people? You know, there's also a verse in Bhagavatam where, you know, or probably in Gita, mm-hmm. where it mentions that the heart of such people becomes steel framed.
Mm-hmm.
So it really like leaves them on that same very platform and blocks the doors for them to think that there's something beyond that.
Mm-hmm. Right. The nature of sakam karma is that. So hardening of the heart means that the seed for spiritual progress does not germinate. There's a verse in Bhagavatam where it says that, you know, that one who cannot cry when chanting should understand that their hearts are steel framed. And excessive indulgence in karma. So like we are doing the verses in NOI, right? So the second verse, what does it say? Atyahara prayaschascha prajalpadiyama. First thing it says atyahara and prayaschas. Atyahara is endeavoring too much. And prayaschas is fruitive activities. You know, it says six things destroy your bhakti there. So, yeah, Ravi Prabhu.
You are telling something?
No, go ahead, it's okay.
Sakam Karma Yoga means like you want something out of it, so you will be highly result oriented. So when we are highly result oriented, because basically from the result we want to find the happiness, so we try for, and we won't get all the results that we want, so we keep on trying
mm-hmm.
for that happiness.
Yes.
And we will be more and more entangled.
Yes, yes. That's a good synopsis of okay, so verse 30. Therefore, O Arjun, surrendering all your works unto me with full knowledge of me, without desires of profit, with no claims to proprietorship, and free from lethargy, fight. So, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna will ask Arjun to fight 9 times. There are 9 verses in which Krishna will ask Arjun to fight. So, in the second chapter, verse 9, if you remember, Arjun said that, Govinda, I will not fight. Okay, gotcha. So Arjun said, Govinda, I will not fight. In response to that position, 9 times Krishna will ask Arjun to fight. 9 times Arjun will ignore the instructions of Krishna. Now, he does not ignore it in the sense that, you know, Krishna has said fight and Arjun says that, you know, I will not fight. Right? He ignores it in the sense that he does not have the full conviction to follow the instructions. So he's looking for more. He's looking for more understanding. So the mood of a disciple is that until they're fully convinced, they will not follow the instructions. They should not follow the instructions of the spiritual master. They should continue to question, to ask and to inquire in a submissive mood until they develop their conviction. Finally, in 1859, Krishna for the last time will tell Arjun that fight. And then right after that, in 1863, he says that you do whatever you want to do. So this is Krishna's ultimate humility. He has spoken the whole Bhagavad Gita And this is the personality of Godhead. God is telling you, it has basically stood in front of you for 45 minutes and explained to you. You know, we get attached to an explanation. Sometimes we speak to some person and then the person says, I really don't want to do this. And then we are like, you know, we spent so much time explaining to him, did not understand what I am saying. But Krishna is so, he has so much humility that he's God, he's explained to Arjuna, and then he says, you do whatever you want to do. And of course, right after that, Arjuna says that my illusions have been dispelled and now I will do as you have instructed me. So in this, this verse is a little bit out of place because it is Krishna's way of, like, you know, when you go and watch a movie, they give those, before the movies, they give the previews for the next movies. So this is Krishna's preview for bhakti. So this is a verse that really talks about bhakti. Krishna has put it over here to plant the seed of bhakti in Arjuna's mind so that he can nourish it later on. So he's saying that surrendering all your work unto me. So now Krishna is saying me. He's not saying that to the Vedas or the scriptures or Vishnu or Yajna. He's putting himself, saying, do surrendering all work to me with full knowledge of me. So this is mode of goodness. Without desire for profit. So the desire for profit comes from the mode of passion. And with no claims to I got a little messed up. So let me go the other way around. So he says, free from lethargy. So lethargy is a symptom of mode of ignorance, right? So he says, transcend the mode of ignorance. And he says, no claims to proprietorship. That is a mode of passion. So he's saying that, don't think that you are doing it. No claims to proprietorship. No desire for profit. So even in the mode of goodness, a person desires a profit. So he's saying transcend the mode of ignorance, transcend the mode of passion, transcend the mode of goodness, and full knowledge of me. So that is the mode of Shuddha Sattva, of purified goodness. So he's saying transcend these modes of material nature, come in the mode of purified goodness, execute your activities for me. So what is this? What does this look like? This looks like bhakti. So it's premature because bhakti can only be done in the context of Krishna. Krishna has yet not spoken about himself. He has not introduced himself to Arjuna. From the fourth chapter he begins to do that. Right now he hasn't said, you read all the verses, he hasn't said, I'm God. Right? For all that Arjuna knows, Krishna is his friend and benefactor. But he's planting the seed in Arjuna's mind. Okay, so verse 31. Those persons who execute their duties according to my injunction and who follow the teachings faithfully without envy become free from the bondage of fruitive activities. So again Krishna is now speaking about Nishkam Karma. So he says according to my injunction. So here he is speaking about according to my injunction in the scriptures. So people who basically this understanding is people who perform the prescribed duties become free from the bondage of fruitive activities. But those who out of envy disregard these teachings and do not follow them are to be considered bereft of all knowledge, befooled and ruined in their endeavors for perfection. So this is the flip side. So it's interesting to note that Krishna's definition of, in the 16th chapter, he gives the distinction between a divine person and a demoniac person. So what is Krishna's definition of a demoniac person? One who acts whimsically. He does not say one who commits sinful activity, one who kills or does and all that. He says that a divine person is one who acts according to the scriptures. A demoniac person is one who acts whimsically. Same point he's making over here, that who disregard these teachings and out of envy. And then he says that they are bereft of all knowledge, befooled and ruin in their endeavors for perfection. So there are so many people that we know who are trying to attain perfection in some way. They are well-intentioned but misinformed. That they'll chant some mantras, they'll do some asanas, they will do something, and they say that this is what my understanding is, that God is in my heart, He tells me what to do, and I do it. But he says that such people are ruined in their endeavors for perfection. So they may be well-intentioned, they want to do something, but they want to improve their lot. But because they're doing it whimsically, they will ruin. Because why is acting whimsically condemned by Krishna? Because when you're acting whimsically, what is actually acting at that point? The modes of material nature are acting. And what is the nature of the modes of material nature? That they will always force you to follow the senses. And they will always take you to the path of sinful activities. It may happen sooner, it may happen later. But it is a certainty that the modes of material nature will always drive you to perform sinful activities. That is why Krishna, it's not that he is saying, I gave the Vedas and since I gave it to you, you better follow it, otherwise you're ruined. But the Vedas are there to protect you against the modes. The modes are debilitating. The nature of the modes is that they will always pull you down. The modes would say that you get up late in the morning and sleep late at night, eat whatever you can, do whatever you need, life is short, enjoy, everybody is enjoying. That's the nature of the modes. You know, they keep telling you that. The nature of the scripture is get up early in the morning, even if you're sleepy, take a bath, follow a regulated life. If you see people who follow a very regulated life, you can see that they develop so much control on the senses, because they are submitting themselves to the injunctions of the scriptures. Even a man of knowledge acts according to his nature, for everyone follows the nature he has acquired from the three modes. What can repression accomplish? So, same point I was making, that a man of knowledge is a person who is introspective, a person who is wanting to learn. But unless he submits himself to the injunctions of the scriptures, he will submit himself to the injunction of the modes of material nature. It is far better to discharge one's prescribed duties, even though falsely, than others' duties perfectly. Oh, I did. Sorry about that.
34.
Okay. There are principles to regulate attachment and aversion pertaining to the senses and their objects. One should not come under the control of such attachment and aversion because they are stumbling blocks on the path of self-realization. So, the modes or the senses will anchor you in this duality. That I like this, so I shall do it. I don't like it, so I shall do everything to avoid it. And as long as we follow the dictates of the modes, we will constantly try to either do what we like and avoid what we don't like. The only way to get out of it is to submit to the principles of the rules and regulations. So even though Krishna over here is speaking about karma, but even in bhakti we see the same thing. That there are do's and there are don'ts. The purpose of the don'ts is to control to establish regulation in our life. That don't eat certain things, don't perform certain kinds of activities. Even if the senses are saying do it, then when you're following bhakti, then you are saying that I will not do it. And the do, of course, is that chant the holy name and associate with the devotees. It is far better to discharge one's prescribed duties, even though faultly, than others' duties perfectly. Destruction in the course of performing one's duty is better than engaging in another's duties for to follow another's path is dangerous. So to further emphasize on the importance of prescribed duties, Krishna is saying that even if you're not good at your prescribed duty, you should do it. Even if you're perfect at somebody else's duty, you should still do your prescribed duty there. Because if people did only things that they were good at, then there would be no notion of submission to rules and regulations. A Kshatriya would say that I'm good at chanting mantras, but I consider fighting as a burden, and he would go and chant mantras. A Brahmin would say that, who has a short temper, would say that I'm better at fighting, and he would become a warrior. So in order to discourage this kind of whimsical changing of varnas and even ashrams, Krishna is saying that what your duty is, you do it even if you're doing it imperfectly, because you're protected. As long as you're doing your prescribed duties, you're protected by that cycle that Krishna said, that the Vedas come from Vishnu, from the Vishnus comes the prescribed duties, and whenever there is a connection, as long as the connection to Lord Vishnu is there, the protection of Lord Vishnu is also there. Arjun, next verse. Arjun said, "O descendant of Vishnu, by what is one impelled to sinful acts, even unwillingly, as if engaged by force?" So Arjun is really impressed by all that Krishna has told him, that prescribed duties are so powerful, that they protect you so much. So the question that he's asking is, if prescribed duties are so great, why doesn't everybody do prescribed duties? Why do people perform sinful activities, and it seems that they're performing it by force, unwillingly? So it's like a person comes to somebody else and say, you follow this path, and you get all these great things. You get protection, you get satisfaction for the senses, and you'll get purified. But the person does not go this way, he goes that way. And then Arjun says, what's going on? Why is the person choosing to go the other path? So in this, Arjun is also hoping that... So Arjun is continuing to look for avenues to not do his prescribed duty. So he is hoping that when he puts his question to Krishna, Krishna might open a loophole for him to exploit. That under some conditions, it is not okay to do your prescribed duty. And then Arjun says, aha, that's me. So, but we'll see how Krishna closes that loophole also. So he says, the Supreme Personality of Godhead said, it is lust only, Arjun, which is born of contact with the material mode of passion and later transformed into wrath, which is the all-devouring sinful enemy of this world. So Krishna starts from the root cause. So lust is defined as the desire to acquire something. So as long as that desire to acquire something is there, two things will happen. You either acquire it or you don't. If you acquire it, then you will either feel happy with it, that I have acquired it, I want more of it, or you will say that this is not really worth my effort, right? If you want more of it, at some point you will reach a situation where you cannot get as much as you want. So money is a classic example, that, you know, we say we want more money, right? For some people, they reach this point where they say, money really doesn't get me everything. My health has gone bad, my family has left me, I have no friends, so they get frustrated. Or they don't get enough money, so they're frustrated that they haven't got what they wanted. So whether you get it or not, you're frustrated. So that's why Krishna says that the nature of lust is that it basically gets transferred into wrath, anger. So frustration is basically the root cause of anger. That this is what I worked so hard to get. Is this worth all the years of my life? So that kind of frustration and anger comes. And he says it is because of that people are compelled to do sinful activities. As fire is covered by smoke, as a mirror is covered by dust, or as the embryo is covered by the womb, the living entity is similarly covered by different degrees of this lust. So this is an answer to Arjun's implicit question, that you have said that lust is all devouring. Does it devour everybody equally? Because if it devours everybody equally, there's no hope. The Arjun would say that, you know, I'm also Jiva and I'm consumed by lust, so adios Krishna, that's the way it is. So Krishna is saying no. Different people are consumed by different degrees of lust. So when an embryo is in a womb, it is completely cut off. It has no idea what is going outside. The womb completely encloses the embryo. So this is the more of ignorance. The dust on the mirror, you can still see the reflection, but it is warped. This is the mode of passion. And the covering of the smoke on the fire is very light. You can still see the heat, you can still see the light in the fire, but the smoke is obstructing it to some extent. So Krishna is saying that people in different modes are covered by different extents of lust. People in the mode of ignorance are fully covered by lust. People in the mode of passion are partially covered. People in the mode of goodness, they are minimally covered. Also can be understood as creatures, as jivas. So the first example is that of plants. The plants have very, very limited consciousness, just enough to survive. The second is the example of animals. They have a higher level of consciousness, but still it is covered. And the third is the example of the human form of life, where the smoke is there, but Prabhupada says that if you blow hard enough, the smoke goes away. And then you come in direct contact with the real knowledge of Krishna consciousness. Thus, the wise living entity's pure consciousness becomes covered by the eternal enemy in the form of lust, which is never satisfied, which burns like fire. So this is the unique characteristic of lust, that the more that you try to satiate it, the stronger it burns. So the example that is given is that trying to satisfy lust is like putting ghee in fire. That the more ghee you put in, the stronger the fire will burn. So Arjun, being a warrior, you know, he is a practical person. So he has understood this philosophy. So he's like, okay, I understand that I need to do my prescribed duties. I understand that the biggest obstacle in me doing my prescribed duty is lust. Now how do I conquer this lust? So in order to conquer an enemy, you need to know where it stays. Two things, where it stays and how to conquer it. So Arjun doesn't explicitly answer that question, but Krishna is answering that. So this verse talks about where does lust reside. The senses, the mind and the intelligence are the sitting places of the lust. Through them, lust covers the real knowledge of the living entity and bewilders him. So the Srila Prabhupada explains that how lust manifests at these levels. When lust is there in the senses, then it is very gross. That we want to explicitly enjoy something. We want to eat something. We want to experience a certain sensation. Then lust that is there in the mind, it forces us to make plans. A mind that is contaminated by lust is always thinking about how to engage the senses. And lust in the intelligence, it bewilders us in terms of who we are. That if our intelligence is polluted by lust, then it tells us that everything is meant for our enjoyment. That we are supposed to be the center of the world. So Krishna says that in these three places, there is lust. In the senses, in the mind, and in the intelligence. So in the next verse, he says, therefore Arjun, best of the Bharats. So he is glorifying Arjuna at this point. He is saying that even though the lust is very powerful, you are the best of the Bharats. The Bharats is a really illustrious dynasty, and of that illustrious dynasty, you are the best member. In the very beginning, curb this great symbol of sin, lust, by regulating the senses, and slay this destroyer of knowledge and self-realization. So Krishna is giving the first clue as to how to defeat lust by regulating the senses. So that is why regulation is very, very important. Even if you do it externally, that the sense of submission is very, very important. As long as we act whimsically, it will not be possible for us to make any spiritual advancements. And as soon as we start submitting to even small, one of the things that we always say is that the first symptom of submission is that you make a promise and you keep it, even if it's a small promise, that don't break that promise. So when you make a promise, then at least you're exposing yourself to a certain rule and regulation, that you make a promise that I'll read 10 pages of Bhagavad Gita, make a promise that I chant 4 rounds or 1 round. The most important thing becomes that you don't break that promise. Because as long as you're keeping that promise, what are you conquering? You're conquering lust. Because lust is that which will cause you to break that promise. The working sense are superior to dull matter. Mind is higher than the senses. The intelligence is still higher than the mind. And he, the soul, is even higher than the intelligence. So, Krishna now gives the second way of conquering lust. So, he is establishing a hierarchy. He is saying that higher than the senses is the mind. Higher than the mind is intelligence. And Arjuna might say, okay, but you said all these three things are already been conquered by lust. But Krishna says, aha, but there is one more thing. There is the jiva. And the jiva is higher than the intelligence. So, he says that you, the jiva, through your free will, can control your intelligence, control your mind, and control your senses. So, ultimately, what brings us to the path of any advancement is our free will. And where is their free will coming from? There is only one thing that has free will. That is the soul. The modes of material nature have no free will. The senses have no free will. Intelligence has no free will. Everything is working under the control of the free will of the jiva. So Krishna is saying that don't think that these things are very exalted. That the sense, the mind, the intelligence, the inert matter, don't think they are very exalted. Because you are sitting at the top of the heap. If you want, everything will follow your desire. And the last verse, thus knowing oneself to be transcendental to the material sense of mind and intelligence, O mighty armed Arjun, one should steady the mind by deliberate spiritual intelligence, Krishna consciousness, and thus by spiritual strength, conquer the insatiable enemy known as lust. So he's reminding Arjun of his spiritual identity. That know that you are the jiva that is transcendental to the material senses, mind and intelligence. You're sitting on top of them. And steady your mind with deliberate spiritual intelligence. So study the scriptures, submit to the instructions of the scriptures, and through that you will get the spiritual strength to conquer the insatiable enemy known as lust. So in this chapter, Krishna introduced Arjun to karma. He gave Arjun the reasons for performing the prescribed duty, the protection that is offered by execution of prescribed duties. Then he spoke about two kinds of karma, sakam karma and nishkam karma. Then he spoke about the importance of karma, that even if a person is nishkam, he should still perform his duty for two reasons. One is for the person's own purification, and the second is to set an example for others. And then he talked to Arjuna about what are the challenges in performing your prescribed duties and how those challenges can be overcome. So this is one of the a symptom of Krishna's genius, that the whole ocean of karma, Krishna has shrunk into 43 verses and explained to us. So, any questions, comments? Yes, Prabhu.
What is Prabhu, Arjun's main shortcoming here, not that Krishna is trying to rectify, because you talked about that lust of mind, intelligence, body, sense.
Yeah.
Where exactly is Arjun faltering, that Krishna is foreseeing and then trying to drive him to the away from?
Krishna is, the main shortcoming of Arjun is, so Arjun himself reveals in the 7th verse of the 2nd chapter when he says karpanya dosha bhavata svabhava prachhami mam dharma samudra cheta. So he says that ultimately he says, I do not know. Right. So that, from that point onwards Bhagavad Gita is spoken. So he says, I have all these things that are going on. I need to fight this battle, but my guru and my grandfather is there. I should fight it, I should not fight it. And then he says, ultimately he says, I don't know. That is what Krishna is rectifying. He's giving Arjun the knowledge. That's why at the end, when Krishna tells Arjun, you do what you want to do, he's not really saying it out of anger or anything like that. Sometimes we get angry at a person, do what you want to do, go away. Right? He's not saying it like that. But he's saying that now you have the knowledge. Now you have the discretion. Now you have the discrimination. Now you examine it and do what you want to do. And Arjun, because he has understood the Bhagavad Gita, he does what Krishna is hoping what he does. So through each of the chapter, he is building Arjun's understanding of essentially the three things. Who Arjun is, who Krishna is, and what is the nature of the relationship between the two. Right? And in that also, because Arjun is an embodied soul, he also explains to Arjun what is his relationship with the material world. Right? And if you see the chapters, they will basically be anchored around these topics. Yeah. Anything else? Prabhu?
So, Prabhuji, in the beginning of the class, you mentioned that unlike on material platform, on spiritual platform, based on whatever your understanding is, you should try to preach.
Yes, Prabhu.
So, I understand that there are various facets that, I mean, it's a long path to come to terms to what the heart of the spirituality is.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, if we are not matured our spirituality enough, would it not be, distracting other people when we try to preach?
Not really, because the key word here is you preach according to your realization. So you're a practicing devotee, and because of that practice, you have certain realizations, you have certain understanding of the Bhagavad Gita, certain understanding of the process of spirituality. Preach according to that realization. Right? So preaching is experiential. It's that, when I started chanting, then I noticed this difference. And it's on a mode of sincerity, that this is what I experience. This is what I understand, that Krishna says. Because if we wait for perfection, we'll never be able to preach, because the soul that is perfected is incapable of preaching. So this is one of the ironies in spiritual life, that when you're a Kanishtha Adhikari, when you're a neophyte, then at that point, you know a little bit, like what most of us, we know a little bit, we don't know a lot, but we know what we know, we also know what we don't know, so we are able to share, peer-to-peer. When you're a Madhyam Adhikari, you're more practicing, so you have more realizations. So Madhyam Adhikari is actually the main platform that people preach from. When you become an Uttam Adhikari, then the quality that becomes predominant in you is that of humility. So an Uttam Adhikari is incapable of preaching because they think everybody is more advanced than them. So they'll never preach to anybody. Sometimes people, souls at the platform of Uttam Adhikari, they come down to the stage of Madhyam Adhikari to preach. But they bring themselves down to that stage. You see, like Bhakti Vinod Thakur, he was an Uttam Adhikari, But he would get himself down to the stage of Madhyama Adhikari and preach. But then many times he would basically display his intrinsic mood, where, you know, somebody would come and say that, this was an incident that once a person went to Bhaktivinoda Thakur and he says, I've come with you to discuss about Krishna. And then Bhaktivinoda Thakur became very happy and he says, yeah, tell me something about Krishna. So, you know, so in his mind, that person came to him that this is a big, you know, big Babaji, he'll tell me about Krishna. But in his mind, he knew very little. So he said, yeah, yeah, tell me, what do you know about Krishna? That's the mood of Uttama Adhikari. They can't preach that way. But, so that's why, you know, you can't wait. You can't say that, okay, you know, next July I'll become Uttama Adhikari, then I'll start preaching, right? So whatever, at wherever stage that you are, you preach according to your realizations, preach by achar, preach by prachar, you know, whatever works. And the big thing is that, the big thing that we are lacking at this point is Krishna's mercy. So this is what will attract Krishna's mercy and gives us the strength to follow through. Yeah? Yeah. Because?
This is like, if a person is doing a like sinful activity or like pious activity, what is actually promoting him from inside? Is it soul, like, is he want to do it, or he is destined to do it, like if destiny is there at all, like? But the main confusion is like when soul is inside us, right? Like, and this body will vanish, like after this life, right? You will get another body. Then why doesn't like soul provoke you to do like bad, good activities too, so that it can use? Ultimately, soul is suffering, right? And the next life also soul is suffering. And then, like, how will we go with that? Right?
So let me give an analogy to explain that. That you know, you go out on the road. And you stop a car, right, a cab. And then you get into the cab, and then you say, I need to go from here to there, right? So the cab driver is driving the cab. The reason he's driving it is because you've asked him to drive, right? But once you ask him to drive and you get into the cab, you have no control on the cab. You know, the person may be driving rashly, the person may be driving carefully. The cab hits somebody and drives over it. Who's responsible for driving it? Is it the car? Is it the driver? Or is it you? So depending on the way you look at it, the person looks outside and he says, that car went over that person, right? But is it the car's fault? No. Another person might say, the driver driving the car went over that person. Is it the driver's fault? Not really. You were sitting in the back seat and you were asking the driver to basically do whatever he did. So everything that is happening to you is because of you only. But it is being enacted differently. When you acquire the modes of material nature, you're voluntarily giving control of your free will to, like, when you get into the car, you're voluntarily giving control to the driver. For the duration of the travel, you're saying that whatever you do is fine by me. So when we take on the embodied soul, we are voluntarily giving control to the modes of material nature. Whatever you guys do, you three guys, goodness, passion, ignorance, you know, fine by me. Right? So, and the modes of material nature, they act through the body. Right? So, ultimately, it's the soul that is doing everything. That is why there is culpability. But it is being enacted through different agencies. It's being enacted by the subtle body, it's being enacted by the gross body. But other than the soul, nothing in the body is alive. The modes are inert, your gross body is inert, the senses are inert, the mind, everything is inert. There is only one thing that is chit, that is conscious, that is the soul. And that is why the soul has, the Krishna says that higher than this is this, this is ultimately the soul. So ultimately it is the soul that is making it happen. The reason that Krishna says, and this is a topic, the reason that Krishna says that the modes of material nature, like when he says prakriti kriyamana nigunakaram, he says everything is happening by the modes of material nature, So in a way what he is saying is, be careful whom you give your control to. Right? When you sit in a car, don't give it to a driver who's drunk and who has, like, you know, who has spiky hair and, you know, three rings on the ear. Look for a person who is a little genteel. The chances of you getting into an accident are much lesser. So he's saying that to caution Arjun and us. Very important for us to give control to somebody or something that is worthy of taking that control. He's not saying that to absolve the jiva of the responsibility. That would be against this, the whole grain of Bhagavad Gita. If, you know, if the modes of material nature are doing everything, and if so many people say that, you know, kya hum kya karein, you know, Bhagwan ki ichha thi, jo bhi Bhagwan karata hai, karata hai. Like one of my uncles, he's like a chain smoker, and I would always say that, you know, don't smoke. And he would say, tum to Bhagwan mein vishwas karte ho, tum to jante ho, Bhagwan kitna powerful hai, mujhse cigarette pilata rehta hai, kya karein. So, you know, he'll basically say that, you know, this is God who's making me do. For these kind of people, Krishna is saying, I'm not doing it. It's the modes that are doing it. So be careful about which mode that you associate with. Sir?
Maybe example, like when we are hopping out for a taxi, at least we have a choice. But does soul also have a choice?
Of course it has a choice. If the soul didn't have a choice, Krishna would not speak the Bhagavad Gita. Right? If you do not have a choice to make a change, then what is the point in listening to instructions? If you were completely bound helplessly, I can sit whole day and, you know, recite the Bhagavad Gita to you. What difference will it make? The reason Krishna speaks the Bhagavad Gita is because the soul has the ability to change. We see that in our lives, that at least amongst the modes, that, you know, gradually we try to move away from the mode of ignorance to the mode of goodness. Right? Why does that happen? We are doing it because of our choice. Because by the nature of the modes, they are captivating. The mode of ignorance will not let you go. You know, the only reason you can go from the mode of ignorance to goodness is because out of free will you make that decision. You always have a choice.
So in this life you have to make a choice so that the next life
can... No, in this life you have to make a choice so that in this life you perfect your life. Don't wait for the next life. You know, next life, who knows what. So Prabhupada would say, finish your business in this life, go back to Godhead. Don't wait for next life. It's like a Russian roulette. Don't know what will happen. You don't know what karma is, how the mountain of karma that you carry from our previous lives, you don't know how that will manifest. So don't think like that, you know, I will chant 8 rounds in this life and then I will start chanting the remaining 8 rounds in my next life. You know, do everything that you need to do while Mahaprabhu has given the opportunity for you to do it. Yeah? Are we out of time?
Yes.
Okay. You have a quick question? Yeah.
While saying that jiva is superior to mind, senses and intelligence, but at the same time, like, we hear that mind is the energy of Krishna, so we have to not defeat it.
Where does it say mind is the energy of Krishna?
Surrender it to Krishna, that way you can control it, otherwise you
can't control it. It depends on the way you look at it. Everything is an energy. The whole material world is an energy of Krishna. Right? Everything is an energy. Nothing that is, even the jiva is energy of Krishna. So nothing that is separate from Krishna. So it's difficult to craft a, you know, to craft a line of reasoning saying, you know, this body, the gross body is also an energy of Krishna, so let me follow the energy of Krishna, or, you know, my mind is energy of Krishna, let me follow the energy of Krishna. The best thing is to do what Krishna asks you to do, if you're sincere, right? Instead of extrapolating and interpolating and coming to conclusions that satisfy your own vested interest, best thing is to do what Krishna asks you to do. Now, Krishna is saying that, you know, the higher than the senses is the mind, higher than the mind is the intelligence, higher than the intelligence is you. you know, if Krishna wanted to say that the intelligence is higher than you, he would have said it, right? He wouldn't have, you know, he wouldn't, why would he lie to Arjuna? Why would he lie to us, right? That the mind is my energy and you are not my energy, so the mind is higher than you. You know, he wouldn't say all that. So Prabhupada would say that Krishna consciousness is very simple for the simple, very difficult for the crooked. So very important for us to take it with a accepting mind. That whatever Krishna is saying, we accept it. Whatever Prabhupada is saying, we accept it. Yeah, make sense?
What is the words for this chapter?
Prakriti Kriyamanani Guna Karmani Sarvasha. 327, chapter 3. So you remember chapter 2 or chapter 1 verses? Next week will be exam. You have to recite all the three verses. Chapter 1.1, 2.12, 3.27. Even you, all three verses. Very easy to remember them. Doesn't take too long. Okay. Shila Prabhupada ki jai.